This is a virtue escapement, and from the 17th century until about 1800, 1820, this is used very roughly. And basically, this escapement is just about the same as you use in a clock. And you can see pocket watches, and these are the really thick ones. And that's really due to construction. I will show you the escapement from 300 years ago. You can see a huge balance wheel on top of that. So here you can see one wheel which is vertical. And there you can see the two pallets. So this is breaking or escaping one teeth at a time. Here's the balance wheel on top. It goes back and forth. And here, beautiful fusée, unfortunately made by child hands, these chains. But such craftsmanship, it's incredible. Snack, 300 years ago this is made. Can you imagine? So now you can see that all really old pocket watches has to be or had to be so thick because one wheel is vertical. So the virtue escapement, thick because of the one wheel. And then Mr. Lepine, there were several others, but he mostly got the credit. Made a very thin movement because he found out that with another type of escapement, all wheels can be horizontal in one plane, so way, way thinner. Around, please don't be picky with years, because there are so many uitzondering. Well, but around 1820 as a rule of thumb. Here you can see, this is more the, like the Lepine from 1820s. But if I show you this one, so this is 200 years old with a main barrel, four wheels, an escapement, and a balance wheel. And 200 years on, it's still a main barrel, four wheels, an escapement, and a balance wheel. Hardly anything has changed. This is a different type of escapement with a barrel, four wheels, an escapement, and a balance wheel. Hardly anything has changed for the last 200 years. And this is the basics of every single mechanical watch. Well, few exceptions, but 99.9999 of all mechanical watches. So hardly anything has changed for the past 200 years. And that's the basic of every single mechanical watch. If it's got a chronograph, a tourbillon, moon phase, date, day, pointer date, whatever you think of, the basic is every single time main barrel, four wheels, escapement, and a balance wheel. Always. This is from around 1820. Just around. And here is the escapement. Then you can see the raised, sorry about that, kind of hard. It's really, really, really small. So kind of hard to get into focus. But you can see the raised teeth. And if I move the balance wheel, you can find it. There you are. You can see the cylinder. Now the teeth is inside the cylinder. Do you see? It's sliding against the tip. And now it's sliding against the side. And now you can see that one teeth has escaped. I'm going to show you in a drawing, so much easier. Here we are. So this is the center, the pivot of the balance wheel. And here you can see the cylinder, right? So that moves back and forth. So if there's if the raised club is first going on the outside of the cylinder, then the cylinder with an opening is moving, then the same club is going to tick here on the inside of the cylinder. That's why the teeth is raised. Hey, Munchy Crunch, hi there. So then first the outside of the cylinder, revolving, inside of the cylinder, revolving, and then the next teeth is going on the outside of the cylinder. So again, an escapement, mainspring, center wheel, third wheel, second wheel, escape wheel, balance wheel. But here is the only difference, the escapement between the wheels and the balance. And as you can see here in the downside of the cylinder escapement is that there's always a connection between the gear train and the balance wheel. Because the teeth are gliding against the outside of the cylinder. So the teeth is pushing either on the outside or on the inside. But it's always pushing against the balance wheel. So that reduces the amplitude. Remember the pendulum and the amplitude? The bigger the amplitude, the more accurate the watch is. Yeah, narcissist, more wear on the teeth. Yeah, definitely. And the balance wheel is slowed down. And as you can see on the model here, there is no connection between the balance wheel until tick, no connection, talk connection. And with the cylinder escapement, there's always a connection. So this is the free moving escapement. Really important for accuracy. And the same here. This is the English lever, slightly different, but. And here you can see when the balance wheel is moving, there's no connection with the lever. Now there is connection and now it's free moving again. So that was a huge step forward. So now we have the huge verge escapement with the vertical wheel. We have the cylinder escapement 200 years ago. Then we have the lever escapement that we are still using. And now I would like to show you why we need this escapement and why it is so important. This is rocket science, trust me. I can get quite passionate about this part. As you know, I am a pellet fork fetishist. This is the pellet fork. And this is the escapement. But with one tick, there are so many things happening on the Swiss lever escapement. It is mind-boggling. I will show you what's going on. Impulse tone going into this side of the pellet fork. Touching. Because the balance wheel is so heavy, mass, it is pushing this aside. But while pushing on the other side over here, so the coming here, tick, this is the first tick, and then it's moving there. You see the difference? Now it's pushing against the side, and now it's moving underneath because the balance wheel is pushing the lever away. Because of this slope, see what happens? The wheel is pushing because the mainspring, all the force is pushing against the wheel and it wants to go that way. Remember the model car? If we release this, all the force is gone. So it's pushing, pushing, pushing this away, you see? Pushing, 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 and still pushing, gedeelde heffing, pushing, 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 and now it's escaped, and on the other side, the teeth is going against the side of this jewel. All the red parts are jewels. So that is going to this side. And then the pellet here is still a bit of space, and the pellet fork impulse is going that way. But in the meantime, so pushing on that side is going underneath, but while this is pushing away, see what happens over here. Because of the force of the mainspring, see what happens here. Now you can see this impulse jewel pushing against that side, right? Came from there, pushing against that side. See what happens if I release my finger. And this wheel is pushing against this. That's the impulse. If you have a swing, the child's play thing, if you push it, it will eventually simply stop. But with this escapement, it is pushing against that side, but afterwards it's getting an impulse. This side is pushing it that way. So now it takes force to push away the pellet fork, and straight afterwards, this is pushing it away. And then you have your virtual perpetual mobile, because it is pushing the pellet fork, but getting force from it as well. That's the impulse. But it only works from this side and this side. If it comes from there, the watch will directly stop. So that's why the safety pin, veiligheidsmes, and the cutout here in the double roller plateau. The pellet fork can only move when the D-shape or impulse tone is here. Now the pellet fork can go to the other side. You see that? Genius. And now, while the impulse tone is busy with the balance wheel moving back and forth, if there's a shock in the movement, and it cannot go the other way, so it will go back, and that's it. So this safety pin is essential, and the length of the safety pin is essential. If you hear one tick in tick-tock, what happens is first tick is the impulse tone, the D-shape against that side, pushing, pushing, pushing. Then this teeth moving from the side over there to underneath, you can hear that, that's another tick. Pushing, 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 because this wheel always wants to go that way. Make sure there's an impulse. So now this side is pushing against the D shape. Third sound. Fourth is this teeth moving to the side there. And then the draw angle, I think it was, take hook. It's moving that way against the banking pins. And then with the push from that side, your balance wheel will move again. And this is thought out, I think, by Mudge. It was the English lever, but mostly in the late 1700s. It's, and there's so much more with the angles, and just this is a science in itself. There's so much going on, it's insane. This Swiss lever escapement has been with us for at least 140 years. 140 years ago, hardly anything has changed with this Swiss lever escapement. That makes our watch accurate, fail-safe, easy to maintain, made sure that mechanical watches were affordable for the working man, made time a personal possession. That has done so much, even in social, in a social background. This really has changed our society, and that's no exaggeration. So, that's about it. Oh, and one thing, yeah, I have to show you this, just for fun. Another escapement. And this is what I like. There's a tuning fork. And here you can see it is moving, but at such rate you can see a wave, because it's moving so fast that the camera cannot pick it up. But it is an actual tuning fork. If you do ping, the sound is one frequency, and the frequency is the rate of a timepiece. These two coils make sure it keeps in resonance, so you got a permanent ping going on, and you can hear it singing or zooming. And what I love about this tuning fork escapement or Accutron in this is how beautiful the second hand is moving. And even in quartz movements, you can still recognize the same layout as the normal watches. A thick pocket watch is way older than the thin pocket watch. And now you know why, because there was one wheel vertical. And this is not really interesting or nice or something special. Oh, and there's no crown to wind it. You need a key. And that will tell you it's probably before 1850. Again, many exceptions, but as a rule of thumb, the key winding just about disappeared around 1850. So now you can open the case. I love pieces of history like that. Still a boring, unassuming pocket watch. And then only a watchmaker will see this. Fire gilded, fast, slow and fast. And you know now the length of the balance spring, thanks to Christian Huygens, will make a watch go slow and fast. And this is with the just a beautiful engraving with the flower. There's no need for that. It's just pride in what you're doing. Nobody will see this because there are two cases over it. And here you can see again with the vertical wheel. That's why this is a thicker pocket watch. But if you can see this, well, at least 200 years old. So nice. So I hope I can show you a bit more about why the inside of a watch is so appealing, so nice, so well made. That's really the attraction, the inside of a watch, and not the brand or the make on the dial. So that's it for me for tonight. So again, thank you so much for your attention, and enjoy your holiday. See ya. Bye-bye.